Dear friends, dear colleagues, I'm so happy to see so many brave people who stay until the end of this conference. We've seen over the last few days a lot of very nice examples of use of the INSPIRE data that we all are struggling to make available. We have seen many examples, wonderful examples of collaboration across sectors, across borders, many inspiring ideas that we can take home. Now, for the last bit of this conference, we thought it would be very good to give you some new oxygen. Some oxygen for your mind to take home on top of all those ideas that you have shared and that you have picked up over the last few days. And for this oxygen, who better could we invite than Professor Roland Samson? Professor Samson is a professor at the University of Antwerpen here, and he's a specialist on green in the city. Now, not just about parks and so on, but also how to use the green in the city to bio-monitor the quality of the life in the city, and especially the air quality in the city. And through this work, he also developed a lot of fresh ideas, fresh air. How can we use the citizen as a scientist, the citizen as a sensor, as a monitor? And we thought that would be something very breathtaking for you all to have him explain how he does that and take some of those ideas to take to your country, to your office, and do something about it. So please, Professor Samson, can I ask you to give your presentation? Thank you.
So first of all, I would like to thank the organization for the invitation and for describing me as an oxygen molecule, which is really very nice thing, because we all need oxygen. I don't think you really need me so much, but anyhow, I will try to give you some ideas on what we did. So I will talk about air quality and other ways to monitor it. So if you look throughout Europe, you will see that air quality is really monitored in very high detail with very specialized monitoring equipment of very high quality. Some years ago, we thought if we installed, let's say, four of these air quality monitoring stations in urban environments, that we would cover a huge part of the city. In fact, by four, we would cover the whole city. What we saw during the years is, in fact, that it's not true. We only cover a very small part of the city, and more in detail, we only almost cover the monitoring point itself. So therefore, we thought, well, in fact, what we do is we need many more of these monitoring stations, but these monitoring stations are very, very expensive and difficult to maintain. It's not easy. And then we were thinking, let's imagine we could use vegetation and we could use leaves as a kind of air quality monitoring stations. Then we have plenty of them. We have millions of air quality monitoring stations. And you find them in many different forms. You find them as herbaceous species, as shrubs, even as trees. So you can choose your device and the place where you are. And so this offers a lot of monitoring possibilities. We were looking for a pollutant that also is rather exclusively determinable from leaves, and we came out with PM. PM is also one of the most dangerous air pollutants, as you know, and if you look how it's monitored, then it is monitored on the fraction of the size. So the blue point on the hair, the magnified hair, of course, is what we call a PM10 particle. It's one of the largest air particles or PM particles that we consider. But you also have smaller particles. And it's very relevant to consider the size fraction of these particles, because the smaller the particles are, the deeper you will inhale them and the more damage they can bring to your life. On the other hand, what we noticed was that PM concentrations outside the city and inside the city seem to be of rather the same level, which gives a kind of a wrong impression that inside the cities the air quality was not too bad. And the thing is that you do not only have to consider the size fraction, but you also have to consider to the composition of these PM. And this composition really differs between urban environment and non-urban environments. And so we were thinking, we were also looking for another kind of approach. And then we said, okay, we will look to magnetizable, mainly iron components in these dust particles, because then we can use non-destructive magnetizable techniques. And you have different kind of sources of this iron into urban environments. Traffic is a major source from the fossil fuel burning, but also from brakes, that if you use your brakes, hopefully. But also from trains and trams, they also, by abrasion on the rails, you also got the release of these iron particles. But also from steel manufacturers, you have them. And also, if there are some construction works, you also have these particles. So the Flemish Environment Agency did a lot of measurement into many cities into Flanders. And I simplify the figure for you. And they compared traffic intensity places with less traffic intensity places. And what we saw is that indeed on the traffic intense places, you find a lot of these iron particles. So for us, this was a clear sign that we could use our technology. So what happens? You have traffic, and the traffic is going on or is not going on in Antwerp, many cases. And so they emit a lot of these particles, and these particles, they are there in the atmosphere, but they don't stay there, of course, because these are particles. They have a certain weight, and the gravity plays its role, and the particle settles down on all kind of surfaces, and could be your could be a neighboring car, could be a house, but also could be, of course, vegetation. So we did a lot of research during the last years, and we did monitoring campaigns in urban environments in the city of Ghent. We really had very detailed analysis of what happens in urban street canyons, and also we compared plants at different height levels to see what's going on, and we wrote very nice publications about it. But then we were looking around and we said, okay, we know what is going on into an urban environment, but all the citizens around us, they do not know. Even if we publish, they don't read our papers, which is logic. So we were not happy because the people were not aware about all this pollution ongoing into urban environments. And then there was a call of the city of Antwerp. They had a kind of sustainable ID on StatsLab 2050, they called it, and they were looking for projects on vegetation. So I give a pitch of 1 minute for a public, and there were a lot of citizens there, and then people could subscribe for the pitch they liked. So that evening we sit together, we brainstormed on what we could do, and that evening the project Airbezen, in Dutch, strawberries, you could call it in English, was born. So what was the aim of Airbezen? It was the idea of it was to estimate traffic-related air pollution into the urban environment by spreading out strawberry plants to the citizens, and the citizens kept or took care for these strawberry plants during the measurement period. So this was a very nice collaboration between the citizens of Antwerp, a kind of very small group of volunteers, and the University of Antwerp. And it was, in fact, an idea which was born on that evening. We had no specific money for that project. So the idea was we gave a strawberry plant. The plant was working during the time when it was placed outside, so which means that a lot of these particles were collected onto the leaf sites. The people harvested these leaves. They sent it to our laboratory, and we did some analysis on these plants. And so we had we hoped for 200 participants, but apparently the people from Antwerp, they really liked the idea, and in no time we had 1,000 participants. We really had to quit the subscriptions because we had no aims to do all the analysis otherwise, but there was a major request for participation, not only from Antwerp, but from the whole of Flanders, and because of language issues, also from the Netherlands. So there was a huge interest for our projects. And so you could see people really participated and they gave all kind of impressions on social media. And people were following, oh, my strawberry has already some berries. Mine is dying. Oh, what is your plant doing? And so also a lot of schools participated, primary schools, secondary schools. It was really a living topic, the talk of the town, let's say, at that moment. We find very nice results. I only give you a glimpse of the results we obtained. But for example, we found clearly that pollution decreased with height. So if you live in a multi-level building, the higher you live, the more healthier it is from a health perspective, from air pollution, for example. But what we also found is we found a background concentration. We measured, don't care about units, a background concentration of 10. The median value was around 60, but we find values which were 40 times higher, which is much larger than the deviation which is found in normal air quality monitoring stations, where they use another indicator for PM. So this is also very interesting. But we found no clear polluted places in the city or less polluted places. It was clear that it really depended on local situations. If you have a lot of traffic and you live in street canyons, then you have pollution. If you live further from this pollution, then the values are better. And this project was also, we collaborated with a village in the Netherlands, but also it was exported to Spain, let's say. And we also worked together with artists. This was a collaboration in Ghent with Ivy Leaves. And we also had a European action done on plane tree leaves, which were harvested in 30 different cities throughout Europe. And all they give us information about, and certainly the last one, on the comparison on the situation in different kind of cities. Very interesting. We also had another major campaign running in Antwerp, and we have actually a new campaign on this with 20,000 participants. But at this time, there were 2,000 participants, again, a major action. We did the same, but now we didn't use the strawberry leaves, but we used the system to hang up, and because we majorly looked to the gas NOx, but we asked the people to wipe off the board, and we did the analysis, similar kind of analysis as for the strawberry campaign, and we find kind of the same kind of results. But here we had a lot of repetitions in the same streets, and we clearly could demonstrate that street canyons with a lot of traffic were really an important place of bad air quality, which was not known therefore, or at least not yet demonstrated so clearly before. But we found, you know probably the situation in Antwerp. We have a major ring road around Antwerp, and then we have the city center. So inside the road, this major ring road, we had high deposition of these particles. Outside, we had less deposition due to the fact that in urban environments, the wind cannot ventilate the system so much. If you go more outside of the urban environment, you have the wind that can play the role. And this is a very important thing. If you want to work in our cities, the health situation of our cities, we need to make the cities open. We need to give them the air that can penetrate and refresh the air. Very important. There was a major debate on the importance of the ring road, but again, you see, near the ring road, we do not have higher values than further from the ring road. It really has to deal with being inside these street canyons or not being inside these street canyons. But also, if you look to this figure and you look to the no traffic zone, even in this very high, majorly polluted urban area, you can create safe places if you ban the traffic. So if you have zones and you ban out the traffic, you immediately see a decrease in values. So even in urban environments, we have major possibilities to work on air quality. And then last year, we had a major campaign in one at province level. We went outside the urban environment. We went to a total province of Flanders, East Flanders, with 10,000 participants we had. So we distributed 11,000 plants. We did 3,000 of these plants we analyzed, and we had all communities there in this province involved. So we did not only do measurements, we also had an inquiry ongoing. And because this is very interesting, who participates to citizen science projects? We asked the age of the participants, and you can see people from 20 years old till 80 years old. All levels of society are represented over there. Also very interesting, many times it's taught, and also people involved in citizen science, they say that it's only for the highly educated people. No, we showed that it's not true. In our case, there are about 30% of the people with the highest diploma being secondary school. So it's, again, we have the total society going on or participating. It was a project on air quality, and we asked people about the use of the car, and you see that the majority of the participants use the car daily, and hardly any people never use the car or only often use a car. But if we asked for the reverse and we asked for public transport use, then we saw that 80% of the people used less than once a week public transport. About more than 60% less than once a month, or a quarter of the people never. So you see the huge possibilities there in changing the way of mobility and bringing people to another way. We asked also, do you think in your family there is somebody who suffers respiratory problems, very difficult work for me, due to air pollution? A quarter of the participants, and you see the number of participants there filling in the inquiry, 6,600 people did so. A quarter of the people said, yes, we have. So this is a huge number, more than one out of four. Why did you participate? So people wanted to know more about air quality, but also because they have worries about air quality and worries about local air quality. But also, on the other hand, they wanted to give a sign to policymakers. 40% of the people, that was the reason for them to participate, and an even equal number because they wanted to participate to a scientific project. That was of equal balance. We asked them, what do you think into the entire year? What is the major source of air pollution? Of course, traffic came out and the cars was majorly there. We also see that, for example, industry was estimated to be 15% about, but also wood burning was indicated. 27% of the people thought wood burning is important. And then we asked the people, do you think you will change your behavior due to the participation of, to this project? And about 55% of the people said, no, we don't. We are not going to do so because we were already aware. Some people were able or aiming to change the behavior in car in case of traffic. For example, we are going to use more the bike or less the car, but less than 0.5% of the people want to change their wood-burning behavior, while 27% indicated it's a major source. Very important, because if you want to do something about it, you see there is a global change of mind to make. The measurements, this is the map of East Flanders that we obtained, and you see immediately the big red area, which is the urban area of the city of Ghent, very beautiful city also. And everywhere where we had the urban environments, we saw these red dots popping up, very important. On the other hand, we have two major European highways, the E17, the E40, crossing the province. They are not popping up. Why not? Because there is a ventilation. In the urban environment, less traffic comes together, but there is no ventilation, and we see the values rising. Another very important issue there was, because of the metals we find, is we have a very important metal factory over there, which is also known by the European Environment Agency, which is not a good sign, as being a bad pollutant. And indeed, what we showed here very clearly, that there is a huge plume of this pollution from this metal factory. It was never shown before. And so here also, we did a very nice job. We asked the people, what do you think about traffic intensity in your street where you placed your strawberry plant? And if people said we think it was a very busy street, we had high values. If people said it was a calm street, very low values, significantly differences. We asked people, what do you think about air quality in your place of living? And if people said, I think it's not good air quality, we have high values. If people say, I think the air is water. Well, we have low values. So it shows that people are able to estimate air quality. We could prove it, which means that if you could build maps, for example, by asking people, what do you think about the air quality in your region? We asked more than 6,600 people. We could create maps like that, which resembles very strong to the measurement maps. We also asked people, what do you think about, we compared with the health-related issues. If people said, we have no health-related issues, low values. If people said, yeah, we have health-related issues in our family, higher values. Significantly differences. And if we calculate this back, it means that more than 60% of the people in the province of Flanders, 60 to 80% of the people of this province would live in areas where there are health-related issues due to air pollution. Yeah? But these measurements and these campaigns that we did, they helped also policymakers. For example, you are here in Antwerp, there is a low emission zone. Well, this low emission zone, the acceptance by the people is helped by this kind of actions. Because we learn the people about the air quality, we give a lot of information and people accept that and they say, okay, now we know and we understand why we should use better cars, better quality cars to go into the city. We also went to the Senate, and also there is a vision on air quality, which is with the input of this of these kind of actions. But also not via policymakers, but also the economic world is reacting to that, because people help making the map, and they know these maps very well. And then people, estate builders, they want to hire or to sell their estate, and people say, no, we don't like to come there because there is a huge pollution over there. And they only can sell their properties if they take some measures to prevent air pollution to enter, like building big screens. There are really very nice examples here. There was a news item the beginning of this year, where they stated the air quality is worse than expected. Why? Because they were using models, but these models were not validated, or at least not properly validated at high resolution. By making the citizen science project, you give the people a lot of thousands of measuring points, which enables them to validate models. And then they create new models where they build in the street canyon effect, for example, where they build in the effect of the traffic and the stopping and the starting of the, and then you come to worse air quality. The air quality itself didn't become worse, but our predictions became better. And so we saw how it changed. And this is very important. The weakness of our project was that there is no direct link with the air quality monitoring standards as accepted by the European Union. But we also could say it's time to change these air quality standards. That's another way, and that's what I hope for, because we need to come to better indicators of air quality, not only PM10, PM2.5, and so on. We also see that indeed sometimes social groups do not participate. So if you really want to include everybody, you have to make a very specific communication. But it is clear citizens are really concerned about air quality, and everywhere where you have motorized traffic, you have the pollution. But the further you go from this pollution, the lower the air pollution will come, or the traffic. But it really depends on local situation. Now, clearly, monitoring stations, we need them, but they cannot cover the entire area. So we need additional measurements, and not only additional measurements, but also additional components should be measured, like soot, but also the one we indicated, and toxicity should be taken into account. And if we want to work with our measurements and we want to compare it to traffic data, we cannot. Because traffic data, a basic data, is completely lacking in Flanders. We don't have this data. Some years ago, they decided not to follow this up anymore. And the data, the kind of data we have, are not reliable. If we ask the citizens about traffic in their street, that's much more reliable than using the official data. To involve citizens, it should be an easy project, easy to understand. It should be a clear win for the participants. And you have to put a lot of communication effort there. We really had an enormous impact. I'm seeing the time is over, so I'm going a bit ahead. But also very important here was that subjective data or apparent subjective data on what do you think about air quality, what do you think about traffic-related data, they are meaningful data. We could find very nice relationships. But it's a very intense process, especially after the project, because then, when you release your results, then all the questions come, and then you really need to be there to answer this. And in our case, most of the time, this was a really voluntary basis. So additional support to help, because the outcome of this project is for everybody beneficial, should be there. And I think also for industries, there is a lot of following up of industries, but industries should be forced, especially those in Flanders, the Netherlands, and so on, to use better available technologies. We use a common European average standard, but I think on local place we should go further because there is still pollution ongoing. Thank you very much.
Maybe somebody has an urgent question to ask. So please, Professor. Okay, come to the microphone, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Ellen Vos from the Netherlands Hydrographic Service. I live myself in The Hague, so we also have some of these street canyons, but we also have some high buildings. And sometimes these high buildings, they get the wind down into the streets. Do you know, did you take a look at an effect of the proximity of high buildings to the air quality in city centers? Thank you.
We didn't study it yet, but it needs to be considered. I completely agree. So what we often did in these kind of studies is that we also use a kind of CFD approach. It's a simulation technique where you can model these wind streams and these air flows. And this is, in fact, very important. So, of course, if you have a very densely built urban street canyon, or you have a very densely built neighborhood with a lot of urban street canyons, and then you will put a higher building, this can have certain effects. What I think what we should do, and that's also the vision of the Vlaamse Bouwmeester, we should make the urban environment more open, and then we can put these higher buildings, but then you do not have this negative effect, because then on these around these higher buildings you could create parks and so on, and you do not have the street canyons. But if you have the street canyons, then probably in certain conditions you can even worsen the situation. That's true. But of course the first item to do is to get the traffic out of these street canyons.
Thank you. Anybody else would like to ask a question? If not, then thank you very much, Professor. And I would like to ask our panel to join me on the stage, because I'm sure that these ideas have brought some reflections in the minds of Hugo de Groof, Rob van der Velde, and Barbara van den Houten. So please, will you join me? Thank you. Okay, we are going to do a wrap-up, oxygenated by the ideas of Professor Samson. So I think, Hugo, I saw your eyes blinking when the professor was talking about how the citizen can contribute and how the combination of official data and citizen science could help us go further in the better creation of a better environment.
Yes, indeed, Ingrid. My eyes were blinking for two reasons. The obvious one that you already mentioned, but also because I am from Antwerp. And I didn't have a plant in my garden, but I've seen that there were many in the area where I lived. So I find these results extraordinary. Congratulations, Roland and the team. This is really what we need. And why do we need this? You know that a number of years ago we had the Aarhus Convention and we have a European directive about public access to environmental information, governments informing citizens. And I continue to say to my colleagues, guys, the world is changing. It's not anymore a one-way street. The citizen has become an observer. And thanks to these research projects, it has become a reality. Just recently, I looked at Eurostat figures on who do people actually trust when they are being informed about their environment. The top category were scientists. Governments, European governments, were only rated at 7%. Local governments even, in that survey, 6%. In between, you had the press, you had the media, you had NGOs, and so on. Is that important? Well, in the days of fake news and alternative facts, people are becoming very suspicious. But they are trusting our scientists. And for us as government, it doesn't really matter, because what we have in front of us is the need to collaborate. And that we have seen expressed very strongly in this conference as well.
Thank you, Hugo. Rob, you walked around a lot and worked, I think, a very tough job to get this conference organized and get all these marvelous presentations. What are your reflections on this?
Congratulations also from my side. And when I was looking to your talk, the thing that struck me most, that it's about the people. You're talking about persons who tell about their families who were, for instance, ill. And I think the people part is a thing which gives the stories, which gives the inspiration. And I think what we have seen here during this week, which was a fantastic week, it was fantastic, is that this is unprecedented what was achieved by this Inspire community. When you look at it, the only thing there was a law. There were several laws. In fact, there was no money, but there was the strive to open up the data from all these governments. And we have seen that maybe 10,000 of legal authorities succeeded. And I think we also saw that this community is very strong. There's so many bottom-up power, and that's also people. That's also the thing I liked. There's bottom-up power to go into the direction of increments like e-reporting. And there is consensus that there is a need to be more, let's say, webby, to be more connected to what's going on the internet. But these are incremental things. And I think what you have brought us, Professor Samsom, is the new narrative, because we were working for empowering the government, helping opening up data between governments. But what you show is that the next step is the cooperation between the government, people at the government, and the citizens. And as well, I think, the cooperation between the private sector. So sharing between government and private. I think that should be, in my view, the new narrative for our community.
Okay, thank you, Rob. One of the reasons why this citizen science can come up like it does, and also in many other fields, is the availability and the accessibility of technology and what we call the digital transformation that we are going to. Now, this is something which is somehow threatening to organizations, governmental organizations. And so maybe you have some ideas, Hugo, how we can... What do you think about this? How can we embrace it? Do we have to try to overcome it? How can we work with... How can we, let's say, digitally transform? What are the things that you picked up over the last 3 days where you say, you know, I heard something there and I would like to know more about that because I think it's important.
Well, the digital transformation of industries, technologies. It is there. It's a train, it is running. So is the transformation, the transition of society, as we have seen. The challenge for us now is in the first place to put this technology to the best use. It is not only about e-commerce services and bringing a package faster from A to B. No, it's also about deploying these sensors, these enablers, this Internet of Things, all this massive bandwidth that we are going to get in mobile networks, and to do something with it. And for that, projects like Airbase, we will see sensors which are measuring soil, which are going to measure water at much more higher densities than ever before. And this for us is clearly a challenge, also within Europe, which is very much driven economically. We need to grow, we need to grow, we need to grow. Yes, perhaps we need to grow, but how we do it sustainably remains a huge, huge challenge.
Rob, when I look at all these challenges, the biggest one I see is the vast amounts of data that are coming to us. And at the same time, I think this is, for the geo world, a unique opportunity to prove to others that we are not just a bunch of weirdos sitting in a separate silo and doing some stuff about maps. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I think that we can do a lot, and that we probably do more now than that we expose. I've seen several presentations from people which are very, very nice and friendly people, but in some cases I thought we could be more provocative, we could be more brave, because I think what you said is true, that there is so many knowledge in this community in handling large and big data sets. But the point is not, of course, that this data is the data for itself, but there's always the need to bring that to information, to bring that to information you can use. And I think the two things which are very interesting of the new technologies is that it can lead, when we do it together, to democratization of data, so that the data comes from all of us. So it's not a professional thing for a selected group of stakeholders. And the other thing is that we will become in an area where we can use it real time. I've seen a lot of applications where we have data from maybe this year and we use that for a forecast. We use it for preparation of policy. But when the data is available daily or hourly, it can help us steering and taking decision on a regular base, on a permanent base. So we will be permanently using data. I think that's the thing which is on the horizon.
Okay, thank you. I can see Hugo wants to say something about it as well.
It's the word provocative that struck me. Now I will be provocative as well. For a number of years, I'm saying to my colleagues, public-private partnerships are enormously important, not only for dealing with the issues, but also for the data collection. Can you imagine if we talk to the car manufacturers, say, we have now all these small sensors. I know there was one manufacturer that was measuring ground ozone, for example, right? We would have a fleet of sensors. I know of projects in the Netherlands where public transport is equipped with sensors. We have heard from TomTom, from Alain de Taille, that they have all these real-time data on traffic density, which is highly needed, as Professor Samson indicated. But the model to exchange it with the public sector for research purposes, it's not yet there. And as you have heard from my friend from the ANSIP cabinet, we are working now on new proposals for what is called reverse PSI, to also bring the private sector data that they collect on all these platforms, from your wearable that you have, that is measuring your blood pressure, to traffic density data, and to put it in the same spatial framework that we have created with Inspire, the more static data. So this is something where definitely over the years to come, I think we should work on very, very hard, Ingrid.
Yes, I can agree with that. And on Monday, we had, before the conference started, we had a summit where a geospatial public sector and private sector met, and this was one of the issues there. I think a very interesting question on about open data. When will the industry make open its data? So I think that's certainly something that we will have a lot of discussions on over the next few years. But we also had some very interesting people here over the last 2 days who were doing stuff that we would never imagine with our data or your data. And so I would like Hugo to present us the results from the hackathon, please.
We have been hacked. Again. It's terrible. I mean, we have been hacked all around Europe over the last years. And these hackers, they have been sending me emails, Hugo, we are hacking there, we are hacking here, we are hacking with students. And I said, what the hell is happening out there? And then I started to understand what they were trying to do. And I must say, it is amazing, because they also keep their finger on the pulse of our data infrastructure. Because what they are hacking is that what we make available. They are not breaking into our systems, but they are hungry for content. And with this content, in these hackathons, they are creating marvelous things. It's organized by, again, one of our many European projects with a man driving it. Karel, thank you very much. For years, you have been a great power behind this movement, I would call it. And as you can see, collaboration, we see here, NextGeos. Geos, a research program set up globally, a global community, but also more European project. We have the participation of the European Satellite Center in Torrejón, which is working on security. We have my friends from the Joint Research Center. An enormous community has participated in this event. As you can see, 16 teams all over Europe engaged into this activity, and they brought innovation. And I remember the G8 Charter on open data. The bottom line is, why do we do this? To promote innovation and to strengthen democracy. And these guys are using this data precisely for these purposes. So thank you very much for that. Of course, there's also competition, right? So there was a group of experts of hackers, I don't know how you call those, expert hackers, who knows. Anyhow, and they had established a number of criteria. Well, what these guys are doing needs to be relevant to INSPIRE, to the Copernicus program, bringing the satellite data, combining it with our INSPIRE data, and so on. They develop application interfaces, they use application interfaces. Very important for our hackers, otherwise they would really have to hack. I mean, come on. The innovation potential of their ideas was taken into account. And the environmental and societal value, I think you can all agree on this. And INSPIRE is about working together across borders and across sectors. And again, that was a criteria taken into account. And of course, it wouldn't be good if they wouldn't come to the INSPIRE conference and make a good presentation. Maturity of implementation, another criteria. So, first of all, there are winners, there are no losers in this. There are just people that apparently knew better, the expert hackers maybe, but no, this is not true. Clearly, this was a great job. And the first one, very funny one, how to plan your trip to the seaside. Great application. I wonder what data they have used for that. Maybe it had something to do with litter on the beach, who knows. Then we had another one that developed an API for analyzing the prediction of vessels and fuel consumption. Very important, we have European directives which regard the emissions on board of ships, the so-called sulfur directive. We are measuring these emissions, an API that can help for these purposes. So thank you to the team. Now, who are the winners? Like I said, there are no losers, but we have three. On the third place, an application, I'm not going to read it out for you, but local intelligence is something we need. Now, what's the difference between information and intelligence? That intelligence puts context to the information. It's a bit like a road traffic sign that says you can drive 30 kilometers an hour. That's information. That's not intelligence. When it becomes intelligence is if indeed you have the law, the rules that will inform you that if you speed, you risk to be fined. So these type of applications are extremely important, and there's a lot of science in it as well, I see. The second place, Team 13. Look at the people that participate at the different institutes. We are moving to the Arctic, a very, very vulnerable area. We have an entire Arctic policy. It's under so much pressure, climate change, industrial developments. So these type of applications are absolutely necessary. Again, congratulations. And then the winner is delimiting agroclimatic zones. With Karel, I see, with Pavel. Guys, you've done a great job. The experts think that what you have done is the best. And of course, the time is up. Now we have a trophy for the winner, which was kindly prepared by our organization committee.
Can I ask the one of the team to come forward, please? Or the whole team?
If you are here.
Well, congratulations. Mind you, it's not always size that matters.
Thank you very much.
So, I'm really happy to be meeting you here, and I hope you have enjoyed the conference. I would like you to just make one statement. What was the most important thing that you learned from this project?
Well, it's a hard question. For me, it's seeing that taking the data from different sources, in our case, EU Digital Elevation Model, together with some meteorological API and together with data from OpenStreetMap, can create a result which could help someone really in the field. In our case, these are farmers. So this is something like if you really combine different domains, different data, you can just, well, let's say relatively easily create something which is useful to end user. Yep.
Okay, thank you very much and congratulations. So, we've seen interesting things over the last few days, and we had two themes for this conference. One was on working together, samenwerking, across borders, across sectors. The other one was make use of the data of Inspire. Now, sometimes people get frustrated because they have to do a huge amount of work to get those data and metadata and to get it all out there and publish it. So, and then when we look at our statistics of the use of these data, sometimes we get so terribly disappointed. I'm sure people in the room will share this. So I would like to know from Rob and Hugo, what can we do to make that better?
To give awards. I really believe in giving the floor and shining the light on the people who already found the way, because they can tell the story. They can take their colleagues. So I think that's a strategy we could do. But there are also things we cannot do, because we cannot imagine all the use which is possible. So we need intermediate people. And so we try to, and I'm very glad that there are many of them here, we try to connect with the people who are in the industry, who have the creativity in the market to provide solutions.
Yeah, so we need middlemen.
But I strongly believe in awards.
Yeah, so awards and middlemen. Yeah, okay. Hugo, what do you take as a possible solution?
Well, I hope you agree that I disagree with what you have said about Inspire. It's understanding what Inspire is. Inspire is, first of all the data that it covers. it doesn't matter if this data is in some kind of data model, if there are some fancy services or whatever. Once they are there, is it then inspired data? No. When the data is there, people can find it, can use it, even as is. They will find their own ways of using it. And therefore, we have seen so many application projects here. And you're right about one thing. If they would have to rely on inspire data models and services being in place to do this application, they may be slightly frustrated. But still, the data is there. It's geospatial data, and it's being put to good use. And that's also inspire. It's the data covered, the access that was given, and the creativity that people had to bring it together for a given application. I often compare it to buying a car. Inspire basically says, I need something that takes me from A to B. The first simple thing that you need, maybe a step, a bicycle, a small car. And then you say, well, I would like to have some options on board. I would like to have fancy services 24/7 available. Your car becomes more expensive, more complicated. And then there is the fully swinging and dancing Inspire. I'm not going to use any brand name, of course. You can imagine what I'm thinking of. It has everything on board. It's great. It's lovely. Fine. Perfect. Great. But let's focus, first of all, on considering Inspire as an infrastructure of people willing to share their data.
Okay, willingness. It's about wanting to get the things done and wanting to be successful. And I think we have, and I will give the floor to Rob, because Rob has the honor to present us to Oh, I'm sorry. Well, I'll leave it to him. He has an award, and he loves awards, so there's the award.
By the way, has anybody seen the golden pineapple? The story is that it was stolen last night. Who of you did see the movie about the story of the golden pineapple which started a year ago? As I said, awards, but also honoring the people who are eager to find the data, because I also agree with Hugo, but I also understand what you said. People who are eager, who have the guts to go behind the portal and look after what is available. And so we are very happy that as an organization, we found six people representing a group of people who are looking for what's in the data and how does it solve my issue, or how could I be creative or innovative with the data. From those six, the jury, after a lot of deliberation, came out with one winner, and there can only be one winner, so there's only one award. And a runner-up, and this runner-up is Maria Andrzejewska. Could you please stand up? Because you gave a very good presentation, and you did a very nice job in opening up the data which is in Inspire in a game which is called EcoCraft, where you and children, young people in your country, learn how to build a city, how to plan a city using the data from Inspire. The winner is, and I'm glad that she is in the room, and I'm going to go to her, because this is really incredible. I saw her, and I saw a T-shirt. Ellen Vos. Come here. You already introduced yourself, because you raised the question. You're from the Netherlands Hydrographic Service. And you did something good. in the Babylonian forest of all the data on the North Sea, which is of value for the wind farms. And how come that you have this t-shirt? Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Sorry.
Where's the box?
Yes, I feel very honored by earning this award. And actually, I think Hugo was just saying what this cooperation is all about. It's about the willingness to share not only the data, but also the knowledge about, in my example, about the oceans and the seas, and the willingness to cooperate between the different domains. And I couldn't have held that presentation if the marine domain wasn't such a friendly domain. So actually, I consider it an award to my community as well. Just thanks very much. And it's all about the climate change also being so very visible at sea. So we can see actually that nature calls, and we all know that if nature calls and you don't act and act quickly, you get into a mess. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Rob. Now, you've all seen Barbara sitting here on the stage and being very beautiful and silent. So I would like to give her the floor because she has a wrap-up of what we did. And please, Barbara.
Thank you, Ingrid. Well, it always helps to take a step back and look at the context we are operating in. And some outsiders would call this very context the box. And you certainly remember last year's conference theme, Inspire a Digital Europe, thinking out of the box. Mr. Hans Bruinings reminded us of the broader picture, the why. In 2050, we live well within the limits of our planet. And to achieve this goal of the 7th European Environmental Action Programme, we all agree here, Inspire can play a pivotal role. But like I just said, it helps to take a step back. So can I entice you to look up for a minute and admire this wonderful whale skeleton? Isn't it amazing? It stems from another time, long gone. A time where explorations of the physical Earth was driven by the thirst for new discoveries. Is it a coincidence that this whale is hanging here in this very room, the Darwin Room? I think it isn't a coincidence. Darwin's interest in marine was what led him to stop his medical studies and eventually embark for his 5 years journey around the world. It's unknown if he liked pineapples, but my guess is he enjoyed coconuts anyway. This journey was nothing more than one long data collection, an activity many of us are still engaged in today. But what we remember of Darwin is not really his journey of 5 years, not his data collection. What we remember him for is the breakthrough that was made possible by combining all these data sets from all over the globe. Indeed, this theory of natural selection came about by combining data sets that were not meant to be combined. And what a breakthrough it was. To me, this is a call for action. A call for action in the sense that we have to break open the walls of GEO and invite other interest domains into it. Before we end up this conference, let me end with my hope that this conference was more than you hoped for and that you received a lot of input that will be the trigger of many long-lasting, enjoyable working hours for you. And it's my conviction that, however, that like everything in life, it has to be balanced. This conference was balanced too. It strikes the balance of work and play, of action and creative thinking, and the balance also of workshops and presentations, followed by some healthy yoga and a jog through the zoo. Which is why, Ingrid, we would like to end this conference with a small visual keepsake to end up.
Thank you very much.
Thanking people. Thanking you all at first to bring all your knowledge and all your ideas and all your humor. It was amazing to be a member of you. Thank you. Thank you. Applause. Thank you, Hugo, for lending us your city. It is your city. It is a city which we learned as a city which is very interesting, because it's a city where so many things come together. Think about the land use in this 500 meter perimeter. So differentiated, so many people, so many culture. So it's complex. It's complex and relaxed. And now I understand how you did this in 13 years. Such a complex implementation and always being so relaxed. Thank you, sponsors. You were great that you helped make this wonderful conference possible by your financial contribution, by your entrepreneurship. And I wish that you had the opportunity to get interesting leads to make more innovations with what you did. Thank you. Thank you for the team. Yes, applause. Yeah. Thank you very much for the fantastic team. A team where people from Informatie Vlaanderen, the commission, and you know from work together in probably a year. And I've been coming to conferences and I've seeing teams working cross-border, but to be honest, I have never seen a team which has so high level of can do as this team. And I want to mention the six people who are a member of the team. Griet, thank you very much. Sophie, thank you very much. Mira, Thank you very much. Marja, thank you very much. Karen, thank you very much. Tanne, thank you very much. Yvonne, I love you. And now I come to you, Uns. Thank you, Barbara, for having this guy in this committee. Come here. Uns, you were always there before we asked that you were there. You always foresaw whatever it was, an issue before it was there, and you always solved it. And you're a cosmopolitan, and you're a very nice guy, and you have so much creativity. Do you mind when I hug you? Well, thank you.
So, here we are at the end of a very inspiring week. And I think there's one question which is still hanging like the skeleton of the whale in this room. When will we meet again? Where will we meet again? Now, just to give you a little flavor of what will certainly be, is I would like to show you as a closing, and after that we will all go to have lunch because we're all very hungry. But just stay, sit and watch this little movie of a marvelous place where we will meet in 2020. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, Croatia. And this is really the end. So have a lovely lunch, have safe trips back home, and we'll certainly see each other again, if not in any other meeting, then in Dubrovnik in 2020. Thank you very much.